Assalamu alaikum. Welcome back to the program Towards the Origin, in conversation with Shaykh Kazi Lutfur Rahman with our tonight's topic, which is consuming halal. Before we went into the break, we have been listening to the actual definition of consuming halal. What does halal consist of? What is the definition of halal? And how halal and tayyib are both related to each other. And one of the aspects that our Shaykh have touched upon is the halal sustenance that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has provided us. Inshallah, we'll be continuing our discussion, but feel free to email us. You'll be seeing an email appearing at the bottom of your TV screen. Should you have any questions or any suggestions, feedback, by all means, feel free to email us at towardstheorigin@chsuk.tv. Now, Shaykh, you did touch upon the in the first segment, the halal and haram issue. Now, the first thing people might have is, as you have slightly touched upon, is now what is haram? We know it's directly mentioned, but something living in a 21st century in a developed part of the world, in a very advanced part of the world, there are some aspects that might not directly haram because it's not mentioned, but then again, it might not directly saying halal.
Yes.
Now, how does as Muslim we balance this out?
Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. Now, Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam said a beautiful hadith on the authority of An-Nu'man ibn Bashir radiallahu anhu, and the hadith has been recorded by Imam al-Bukhari and Muslim rahimahumallah. And they said, "Innal halal bayyin." Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam said that indeed halal is clear and plain. It's clear. "Wal haram bayyin." And the haram is also clear and plain. It's mentioned directly in the Holy Quran and in the hadith of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam. And earlier I wanted to say that we in our society we have some people saying everything is halal, meaning a tendency of making things permissible, even though it may not be permissible originally.
But then again,
on the other hand,
everything is haram.
Yeah, haram. So that's what I wanted to say. And we've got a group of people who have the tendency of saying everything is haram. And you know, this is just it's very, very funny, and as well as like I can see the imbalances there.
And without any dalil, any evidence, burhan.
Yes. You see, our imams, especially the great scholars, Imam Abu Hanifa, Imam Shafi'i, Ahmad bin Hanbal, Imam Malik, they used to say that they would be very, very careful to say the word haram, because.
And why is that?
Because just the way if you say something halal and that's haram, you get sin. Similarly, if there's something haram and it is halal in fact, in reality, then you get sin for that, because you are taking the authority of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He's the musharri', he's the lawmaker. So when you come and say, oh, it's haram, and it's not haram originally, then you are taking that authority of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala.
Let's put it into perspective. In today's, we have legislation in this world, especially the country that we live in, mother of all democracy, we have got legislation, laws in places. Now, tomorrow, if someone tells us this is not legal, this is legal, is it not a punishable offense?
Absolutely right. So not anyone and everyone, Tom and Dick and Harry, like come and say,
has the authority to comment on legal matters. So why
comments.
Not Islamic legal matter? Then I think we should have the same standard then.
Absolutely right. So, but obviously, like, you know, we have a lot of works to do. So now Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam said, "Innal halal bayyin wal haram bayyin." Halal is clear and haram is clear. And I remember one brother, when we were studying actually abroad in Egypt, one brother one day he was saying, and we were having a discussion about smoking, and he was saying, "Halal bayyin, haram bayyin." You know, the halal is clear and haram is clear. And he didn't say anything else. But he doesn't complete the hadith where Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam said, "Wabaynahuma umurun mushtabihat." And in between halal and haram, there are confusing matters. Umur, mushtabihat, confusing matters. Because some said halal, some said haram. I mean, some said makroom, disliked, some said it's okay.
Does it mean it's not a clear picture?
It's not absolutely halal or haram, but in between halal and haram. So therefore we have, when we talk about the Islamic law, we've got haram completely prohibited. Then we've got makroh tahrimi, like strongly disliked. And then we've got makroh tanzihi, like slightly less disliked. So we've got all those, and then we've got mubah, permissible, and then we've got mustahab, recommended, and then we've got sunnah, highly recommended, and then we've got fard, wajib and fard.
So for a common Muslim, it's very difficult to understand those terms.
I mean, obviously these are fiqhi matters, but luckily many Muslims know, those who practice the religion, they know what is the difference between fard and wajib. According to Hanafi school, there's a difference between fard and wajib. According to other schools, fard and wajib is the same thing. And then we've got sunnah mu'akkada, sunnah ghair mu'akkada, and then we've got mustahab. And in terms of the haram, we've got makruh tanzihi, makruh tahrimi, and then we've got haram. So we have got confusing matters between halal and haram. Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, لا يعلمهن كثير من الناس. Many people do not know them. And then he said, فمن اتقى الشبهات فقد استبرأ لدينه وعرضه. Whoever can avoid or avoids the confusing matters, then he saved his religion and his honor. So it's important for us to stay away from the shubuhat or the confusing matters as much as possible.
Doubtful matters,
yeah. And then he says, وَمَنْ وَقَعَ فِي الشُّبُهَاتِ وَقَعَ فِي الْحَرَامِ. And whoever falls into the shubuhat, confusing matters, then he has fallen into sin. وَقَعَ فِي الْحَرَامِ. He has fallen into the haram thing. كَالرَّاعِ يَرْعَى حَوْلَ الْحِمَى. It's like a man who is grazing the pasture to his cattle, or he's feeding grass to his animals. And كَالرَّاعِ يَرْعَى حَوْلَ الْحِمَى. Around a sanctuary. Sanctuary, obviously, it's a sacred or secured place. Now, animals, like any chance, they will get into that. An animal will soon go to that sanctuary or the secured place, a place which has been made sanctuary or secured. Indeed, every kingdom or every king has a sanctuary, a place of sanctuary, a secured place. And the sanctuary of Allah is the prohibition, the prohibited matters. And then he says, "Alaw inna fil jasadi mudgha." Indeed, in every body, human body, there is a flesh. Ida saluhat saluha al jasadu kullu. If that flesh is sound, then the whole entire body is sound. And if that flesh is corrupt, then the whole entire body is corrupt. And then his heart. "Alaw inna fil jasadi." So we can see there are things in between halal and haram, and they're called doubtful matters. And as for any Muslim who is conscious and who is respectful towards his religion, he will try and avoid the doubtful matters. However, if anything, any matter which is differed amongst the scholars, amongst the reliable, genuine scholars,
difference of opinions,
and a Muslim is following a genuine opinion, then we cannot come and say, "Oh, you don't follow that opinion."
When you say following a genuine opinion, you mean following from a genuine, bona fide, qualified scholar.
School, like for example, genuine madhab or genuine school. Mm. And someone might be following a different opinion of a different scholar, which is again rooted to the Quran and Sunnah. Then we have no right to say, you are going to the doubtful matters or confusing matters. But generally speaking, you have gone to a supermarket, you don't know whether it's halal or haram. So most likely can be haram, then you just avoid.
Yeah, for example, when it comes to buying food products.
Yes.
So just to give an example, we're not sure whether that particular contains anything haram
exactly,
or explicitly.
But we have other alternative options which we can take. We can take different products. There are numerous a range of products in drinks and foods, breads, whatever you name. We can take alternative method.
Or what about the cosmetic products?
Again, same here, consumption. And we have to be very careful about cosmetic products as well. When it comes to spray, we have a huge confusion about using spray. There are differences of opinions amongst scholars regarding using the spray. So some say the alcohol that within the spray is it just kind of fades away, and it doesn't remain in the body, and so therefore some scholars see it as permissible, but others still see as it a prohibited thing. So different opinions are there even in cosmetic products as well. After talking about the shubuhat or the doubtful matters between halal and haram, we probably should talk about...
This is where I wanted to get into now. Where as soon as you go halal and haram, the definition of halal and haram, the first thing that comes to our mind is the source of income.
Mm-hmm.
Now, in today's world, we've got various sources of income.
True.
Now, sometimes it's challenging, it's difficult because of the circumstances, mm-hmm. because of the ability, because of the restriction, because of the area and place that we live in.
And challenges are there.
And challenges.
Restrictions are there.
But then again, when you say challenges are there, challenges has been there since last 1400 years ago. The challenges has always been there.
Very true.
Now, as Muslim, how do we balance, or what are the different forms of source of income? And what are those that might be considered as lawful, and if there is anything that considered to be unlawful in today's context, especially yes. living in here in Britain and Europe?
Now, first of all, there are many different ways or many sources of non-halal income. And we have to be very careful. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, لَا تَأْكُلُوا أَمْوَالَكُمْ بَيْنَكُمْ بِالْبَاطِلِ. Do not take the wealth or the income or money or earning unlawfully, unjustly. And believe me, whenever we look at something that is prohibited in the religion, we see that it connects with a lot of social or economical and political problems in the world. So let's first of all, let's talk about, for example, the alcohol. Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala says in the Holy Quran, يَا أَيُّهَا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا إِنَّمَا الْخَمْرُ وَالْمَيْسِرُ وَالْأَنصَابُ وَالْأَزْلَامُ رِجْسٌ مِّنْ عَمَلِ الشَّيْطَانِ فَاجْتَنِبُوهُ. Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala says, all you who believe, indeed, إِنَّمَا الْخَمْرُ, the alcohol in its all forms, وَالْمَيْسِرُ, and also gambling. So we see people want to make money out of money, gambling. And well, Islam, during the time of the Arabs, and perhaps even some people even might be up until today do, they used to send arrows to decide whether they should do an act or not. So
it's a form of gambling, I believe.
Yeah, it's like alternative to istikhara. Obviously, istikhara is we do through Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and His help. But this is just that you send an arrow and then you see whether if it goes to a specific direction, then you decide whether it is to do or not. So, إِنَّمَا الْخَمْرُ وَالْمَيْسِرُ وَالْأَنصَابُ, alcohol in its all forms and gambling and sending arrows, all of those things are, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, رِجْسٌ مِّنْ عَمَلِ الشَّيْطَانِ. They are impure and they are also handiwork of Satan. رِجْسٌ مِّنْ عَمَلِ الشَّيْطَانِ فَاجْتَنِبُهُ. Then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, avoid them. Stay away. He didn't say don't do it, but he says stay away from them. فَإِجْتَنَابُ, the word إِجْتَنَابُ is to stay away. So stay away from them. فَاجْتَنِبُوهُ لَعَلَّكُمْ تُفْلِحُونَ. Perhaps you'll be successful. Now, some of us might think, well, alcohol, it was, how can that be, that way it's made haram? Alcohol was permissible in Islam, at the early stage of Islam. Even Sahaba, radiallahu anhu, some Sahaba used to consume alcohols. Now, when the society witnessed lots of problems, like when people lose their mind, they become unconscious, then you see the turmoil that take place, and especially when it's consumed excessively. And therefore Islam comes and aims to make a society peaceful and a society which lives in harmony. And I just want to mention, like, if we want to see the example, we see when we go to the hospitals, for example, during the weekends, in many societies, and we see the amount of patients there, and many of the people are in the hospitals because of the fight.
We know the NHS have got a big budget kept aside for people who have got alcohol-related issues,
yes.
disease, yeah. illness, and in youth we have heard about that word binge drinking. Mm. And because of that, for example, whenever there is a festive season or holiday seasons, we know the NHS, the ambulance services, how busy the emergency staff
exactly.
how busy they are.
Even normally we witness that on Fridays if you go to the hospital.
Friday nights, yes.
Friday
indeed.
Night, you see yes. lots of patients there, even though there's a low number of doctors there. So again, Islam aims to make, again, maqasid al-sharia, what's the aim and objective of the sharia? It is to create, establish a society which is a society of peace and harmony.
Yeah. Just to clarify a little bit, when you said the Sahabas also had alcohol, mm-hmm. just to clarify a little bit there, because alcohol was prohibited in three stages.
Exactly. It was a okay. gradual prohibition.
So it didn't
come to Allah Tabaraka Ta'ala didn't prohibit in one go.
Because okay, so obviously, at that point it was allowed.
Yes, yes, okay. yes. And the nature of the human being is people can't get rid of something directly or straight away. It takes time.
Even today when we see our health services, even when someone wants to give up smoking, we can't tell a person
yes.
to give up smoking
yes.
instantly. There are
yes.
stages to go yes. through.
Then in this verse, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, إِنَّمَا يُرِيدُ الشَّيْطَانُ أَن يُوقِعَ بَيْنَكُمُ الْعَدَاوَةَ وَالْبَغْضَاءِ. Indeed, the Satan, one of the primary duties of demon shaitan is to cause the adawa, enmities. And you see a lot of fights based on money, wealth, the money. So when people go to the unlawful or unjust way of earning or getting income into their life, they go through a lot of difficulties. And shaitan wants to create enmities, adawa, والبغضاء and hatred, عداوة والبغضاء في الخمر والميسر ويصدكم عن ذكر الله. And most importantly, Shaitan wants to keep everyone's away from the remembrance of Allah تبارك وتعالى. So we have found this is obviously a form of also income which is not permitted by our beautiful religion. Then we also find there are other ways, other forms of income that people may have in this world, and they're also not allowed. So we talk about the rashwa, a big problem in the Muslim world generally, and in all over the world. Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said in a hadith, and that is on the authority of Abu Hurairah radiallahu anhu, mentioned in the book of Ibn Hibban, rahimahullah, in his book, it says, لَعَنَ رَسُولُ اللَّهِ صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمُ. Look at the word, لَعَنَ. لَعَنَ رَسُولُ اللَّهِ. Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam cursed, he done لَعَنَ upon the people, الرَّاشِ, who takes the rashwa, who receives the rashwa, who receive the bribes.
Bribery.
Who receive the gush. In Bengali you say, الرَّاشِ وَالْمُرْتَشِ, and the one who gives it as well.
So the giver and the taker.
Giver and taker, both. And Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam cursed the both. Yeah, Rashi wal Murtashi.
But there is a question here now, especially we don't see it often. I mean, in developed countries, there might be some incidents here and there. But especially in developing countries, especially our country of origin. Now, giver is understandable, a taker is understandable, a person who takes it. But someone who gives, now he is put into a situation that if he wants his job to be done, there is no other way than to give the bribe amount.
I mean, this for example, when it comes to
his own asset, securing his own asset, or getting permission for an asset, or for example, a thing that is lawfully his, yet because of the
I understand
position he's in.
The difficulties in some places, and system has been made in such a
corrupt
way
to the core,
that it's just that it's all about this rashwa. Without bribery, you cannot do anything, even to get a job, even to get into an university, to do anything basically that is good. You may be qualified, but you're not getting that.
Or even your own asset, just to register it on your name.
Exactly.
Now, so what should one do?
Unfortunately,
then?
Unfortunately, as I said, look, there is general ruling, and we must mention the general ruling. Then we may be in situations as well, and Islam considers the situation and circumstance.
You mean the exceptional circumstance?
Circumstance. And we know the word darura, and darura, when we say, we mean the dire necessity. Not just that you may think it's needed and you just do it, but dire necessity. So there are exceptional situations where we are unable to do certain things.
That means it needs to be referred to the scholar, case by case.
Yes, but especially the one who's taking, he has no justification. Mm. So the one who's taking. So الرَّاشِ وَالْمُرْتَشِ فِي الْحُكُمْ. Prophet ﷺ cursed the one who gives the bribery, gush, and the one who takes the gush, and in order to influence a judgment. This hadith specifically mentioned about the court, and we see the amount of bribery take place in our courts in the Muslim world.
And now, if that, and now we know how judges are very respectable persons or personalities in the society, and those judges have happened to be taking bribes directly or indirectly,
and
because of that, which had an influence in the legal matters, even take someone else's life.
Imagine like the amount of the oppression, the dhulm is there, and Allah won't forgive, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala won't forgive anybody influence the justice. Influence a judgment, and this is.
And if innocent life has been lost because of misjudgment.
Exact misjudgment, absolutely right. And then we also see that income comes through interest, which is a very easy way for making money. And we as Muslims, we think, experts in economy, they made it very clear that the today's imbalance of the economy is because of the system, the capitalistic system, or the
interest-driven system.
Yeah, system based on interest. You will know much better. You work in a bank, and those who are involved in the economy, we will know much better. So interest has been made unlawful, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, again, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said in hadith, the la'ana akil al-riba, that messenger, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam la'ana akil riba. Sorry, similar to the hadith before, the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he cursed the person who takes the riba, interest.
A lot of Muslims have no understanding of interest here. Mm. They do not understand the definition of interest. They have their own understanding of interest.
Yes.
They say interest, this riba is not this not interest.
See, this is another big misunderstanding in our side. People think every interest is haram. In the modern world, they name certain things interest, but it is not the interest which is the riba, which is prohibited in Islam. For example, I give you the clear example that when you buy or purchase an item and the finance is given by the same company, so for example, you're buying a mobile phone, costs £500, and the company says, look, if you buy it now, you give me £300. But if you give me over the period of 1 year, a year, whole year, then you give me £500. This is a right of a seller. He has that right to say. But to keep taking third-party finance, this is prohibited in Islam.
No.
So again, riba, interest generally, again, making money out of money is prohibited. Making money out of money is prohibited.
We are just coming towards the end of the program. I just want to finish it off. I know we've got a lot of things to cover.
Exactly.
Just if you can summarize in 30 seconds, what effect will it have in a society if we do not have halal sources of
effects,
income?
First of all, the wrath of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, anger of Allah, dua would be accepted. And I wanted to mention a beautiful hadith, and this talks about the dua. A man who was disheveled and he comes and he's like a saint, a wali, and he's stretching his hand towards the sky and he's making dua, but his dua isn't accepted. Prophet ﷺ, he said, because his income is haram, his food is haram, his money that he earns is haram, is from the haram source. And I believe that because we do not have enough trust in Allah, tawakkul on Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala,
firm
just
belief
for some
and faith
extra
in Allah subhanahu
income, some luxury life, some extra £1,000.
Or just to compete with Allah while sending the society.
Society and to keep also peers pressure, wives pressure, or the people around
family
them.
Family pressure.
Family pressure.
Successful
oh, you have to,
life.
He's making that much money. Why can't you make that much money?
Correct.
So all those things have an effect on a person, but we have to do ta'awun. We have to help one another to bring ourselves into the haram, asr halal, direction.
And just to add a little bit there, and if we know someone is involved in haram activities or haram source of income, instead of saying it directly, blatantly, or shaming or naming them,
of course,
we should be
must.
Use
I know,
our wisdom.
I know that we have lack of knowledge, we have challenges, but we have to preach one another and we have to advise one another, and we cannot remain just silent. As a murabbi, as an imam, as a scholar, khatib, we have the responsibility,
inshallah.
Otherwise things goes on.
Okay, jazakallah khair. Our hour is up, and I know there's a lot more to cover, but unfortunately,
yes,
time is
I
up now. Jazakallah khair for coming here and inshallah sharing your knowledge with us.
May Allah bless you, inshallah.
With this, my dear viewers, we have come to the conclusion of our tonight's program. Our tonight's topic was consuming halal, a very important subject, time relevant, and it's a subject that not many of us as Muslims don't even take it seriously. It is such an importance to us, a very, very important thing, an obligation to us as Muslims, that we not only need to ensure that we have halal, not only in our foods, but in our every way of life, in our dealings, mu'amalat, in our daily day-to-day life, needs to be completely halal. One of the beautiful aspects that's been touched by our guest here is when it comes to business, tijara. Now, a lot of us are involved in activities that we all know as Muslims that they are directly prohibited, whether it be alcohol or interest-based businesses. May Allah give us the ability to abstain from it. And as rightly Sheikh has mentioned, the tawakkul, the firm belief and faith in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala should develop this, we should inculcate within ourselves, that will enable us to inshallah abandon those prohibitions. And the other important aspect is that we see a lot of issues in our community. It is that we do not have a formal sort of agreements or contracts in place that leads to a lot of mistrust, a lot of problems within the families or even extended family. So whenever we involve in any sort of legal halal businesses, we need to ensure proper contract, proper agreements are in place, whether it be our family or outside the family, so that these kind of things that are there in the future or happens in the future can be avoided. With this, we end our program for tonight, inshallah. Until next Friday, from Towards the Origin, subhanakallahumma bihamdik, ashhadu an la ilaha illa ant, astaghfiruka wa atubu ilayk, wassalamu alaykum wa rahmatullahi ta'ala wa barakatuh. Thank you very much, Sheikh.
Barakallahu fikum, may Allah bless you, inshallah. Shukran.